Today's curiosity is assisted by Deadfall Cascadian Dark Ale from Torque Brewing in Winnipeg. They describe it as being dark in appearance, having a resinous pine and citrus and malt aroma with hoppy and robust tastes. That hoppiness and citrus is a little bit more than I normally go for, but the malt's coming through, so I'm good with that. Today I am looking at this unit that I picked up at a thrift store for a whole $11.99. This is a network video recorder, aka security camera recorder. On the back of it, we have 48 volt DC input, a VGA output, an HDMI output, two USBs, all-in connection, and then four power over Ethernet, PoE Ethernet ports, which presumably are intended to go to security cameras. So if this thing works, I might actually try and put it into use. And if it doesn't, well, hopefully the video makes enough money to pay for it. There is no guarantee on that part, though. So there's four screws holding it together, two there and two down here. So before we power it on, let us just open it up and see what's in here. Do you have any guesses? Do you think there'll be a hard drive in it? What else do you suppose might be in something like this? Not a lot, it seems. And no, there is no hard drive in here. But that looks like standard, that looks like standard stuff, so that's good. And what do we see down here? Let's start over on the left-hand side. Here is the Ethernet connections, power over Ethernet connections going out to the cameras, and it looks like each one of them has a protection diode. And then there are two of these chips which, if I had to guess without looking them up, are probably Ethernet transceivers of some description. These are 10/100 base team magnetic modules, aka isolation transformers. Turn ratio of 1:1. So this data sheet's a little bit short on information, but what I interpret here, we have two core transformer or two winding transformer with center taps on both of them. That provides the galvanic isolation. And on the secondary side, we have some series inductance, presumably for common mode suppression. And down underneath those two, we have these two guys, which are also identical. RTL8306M. Oh, and those are both Ethernet switch controllers. Okay, six port switch controllers. Okay, it looks like there's five physical transceivers and one for internal management. So yeah, four facing the outside world and one facing inside the box to connect to the other one. Okay, that makes sense, I guess. There is all the different magic that it can do internally. Feel free to pause if you want to read it further. So that kind of takes care of this side where the cameras connect to. There's another Ethernet type isolation transformer for this port here, which is what you connect to your office LAN or wherever. And then everything else pretty much is handled underneath this heatsink by presumably some sort of a system on chip. Over here we have power stuff, we have a backup battery, inductor capacitor, obviously power supply stuff, optional other capacitor, 48 volts input, power supply chip, more inductors, so presumably two or three different voltages inside. But until I power this thing on, I don't really feel like cracking that heatsink off and seeing what's underneath it. So shall we power it up and see if it works? If I can get it to do anything. I'm going to leave the cover off of the thing for now, just in case we need to do anything inside here. And I will grab an HDMI monitor and hook that up and then power this guy on and see what, if anything, happens. Nothing. Nothing is happening. Well, that's anticlimactic. There is one lone LED on inside here and another one up on the front panel. But other than that, I'm not getting any signs of life out of the thing.
So
While we're waiting for this thing to boot up, we'll just go and see if we can find it on the internet. And apparently it is a discontinued product. It's capable of handling up to 8 cameras, 1080p, 4 megapixel. Sure. And we have manuals over here, and it looks like the most recent firmware update is from 2019. So, yeah, this thing is a little bit out of date. But here is the manual, and if you're interested, I'll put a link to this down below. If you don't have one of these things in front of you, it's probably not all that exciting. But it can do all kinds of things. It can control pan-tilt zoom cameras. It has motion detection settings and all that kind of stuff. All what you would expect. Various different compressions and, yeah, all kinds of different standards and whatnot. Seems like a fairly capable unit. Oh, hey, we got a splash screen finally. Something is happening. Okay. Oh, and it's gone. There. Is that a little bit better angle on the thing? Yeah, there we go. I've connected a mouse to it. So it seems to have some sort of startup wizard. English, yeah. Do all these things. There is no hard drive, so we can't initialize that. I don't care about that stuff. Next, yes. Menu, add IP address and stuff. Exit. Exit the wizard, yes. Okay. So what have we got on the screen here? Looks like we've got one main camera screen and then 7 other cameras around. So you can just probably pop whichever one you want up into the middle there. That one seems to have an alarm, probably because it doesn't exist. And they've all got the same kind of menus on them. Playback, close, and live view. Uh-oh, there's a password. And it's not just the default password. They've actually left 2 passwords in it. Forgot password. Import a password from somewhere, I guess, but I don't have that. That's a problem. So how do I get into menus and stuff about this thing? Right click. So we have a common menu for normal pan tilt zoom images. And it wants passwords for all, for pretty much anything. Menu, add IP camera. Can't do anything without a password. So I wonder if, pulling the power on it, I wonder if I pull this battery out, if it will forget its passwords. Would that be a reasonable thing to do? To send it back to factory default passwords? Come on, get out of there, you. Let's let that sit out for a few minutes, and just in case some of these capacitors have to discharge, and we'll put the battery back in, power it back on, and see if it's forgotten its passwords. All right, battery back in again, power back on again, and wait for it to boot up. Yeah, the light's on, so just wait for that to boot up and the monitor come alive again, and we'll see if that did anything. So we're back to the same menu again. Exit that, yes, menu. Switch user. No, both are still there. Let's see how lazy they were. Nope. But power cycling it to reset my number of chances again. Okay, let me just check the manual and see if there's a default password there or something.
Ooh, no, there is no default factory password. When you first boot the thing up from new, it asks you to set a password, which presumably the original owner of this thing will have done, at which point there will be, okay. Let's see how that password recovery works. Oh, okay. So you can back up your passwords to a USB drive, which of course I don't have their USB drive. It also warns you about strong passwords, so it probably has one. Oh, damn. And then you have to set up the unlock pattern, which of course I don't know that either. Although, let's try the one that they suggest in the manual. Do you think they would have been that lazy? There, 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 and there. That's the one that they... No. Let's get it to lock me out, I guess. Nope. Oh, okay. So I can try every minute. But I don't want to brute force it. It could be anything. I mean, I can go through and try all the common ones, but I'm going to guess that since this thing enforces or at least strongly recommends strong passwords and tests them, that this isn't going to be just the common run-of-the-mill 1234 or any other normal standard password. It's probably going to be something that I can't crack. That's kind of disappointing. I mean, it should be expected, I suppose, but you always like to hope, right? I'm going to do a little bit of digging around on the web and see if I can find a factory default reset for this or something like that. And I'll get back to you in a minute or two. After a bit of searching around, I found this YouTube video, which shows that there is a switch inside that you can press to clear the passwords. So I'm going to give that a try. Although on mine, I don't have any switches on the board. There is a footprint for one there, which is labeled SW1. That's the one that the guy in the video shows. So since there's no switch mounted on those pads, I'll just use a pair of tweezers. And he said you have to hold it for about 30 seconds, at which point the screen will go blank. I think you can see, yeah, the alarm bell on the screen. His, the one that he was playing with, had a little beeper on the board. This one doesn't. And I don't see... Oh, no, there's a BP1 and plus and minus, so that's also not fitted. So this one is probably just an older or cheaper version than the one he had. So, there, my tweezers are now a switch. So now I just have to wait for 30 seconds or so for things to happen. But for you guys, I'll spin time forward until something happens. Well, after holding that there for over 2 minutes, that did nothing. So either this guy's got different hardware, which he may have, because, like I said, this one doesn't have the button fitted, different firmware, or a completely different unit. Although it is the same brand, he doesn't talk about the model number, but when his rebooted, I noticed that his splash screen is quite a bit different than this one. So I'm going to keep looking, but you've got the model number from before. If you have any other information about how to do that on this thing, drop me a line down below, I guess. Meanwhile, I don't think there's much else I can use this for. I suppose I could use it for an Ethernet switch. Just without any of the other functionality, just run it as a dumb Ethernet switch. But beyond that, there's not much I can do without the password. I guess I could spend the next year trying to brute force this thing, but that doesn't seem like a productive use of my time. Oh, hope you found this less frustrating than I did, at least a little bit interesting. I suppose at minimum I've got a disk drive cable that I can use. Other than that, yeah, thanks for watching. Questions, comments, and solutions to my question down below if you got them. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.